Akin to Love by Lucy Maud Montgomery. Akin to Love, Lucy Maud Montgomery. David Hartley had dropped in to pay a neighborly call on Josephine Elliott. It was well along in the afternoon, and outside in the clear crispness of a Canadian winter, the long blue shadows from the tall fir trees behind the house were falling over the snow. It was a frosty day, and all the windows of every room where there was no fire were covered with silver palms. But the big, bright kitchen was warm and cozy, and somehow seemed to David more tempting than ever before, and that is saying a good deal. He had an uneasy feeling that he had stayed long enough and ought to go. Josephine was knitting at a long gray sock, with doubly aggressive energy, and that was a sign that she was talked out. As long as Josephine had plenty to say, her plump white fingers, where her mother's wedding ring was lost in dimples, moved slowly among her needles. When conversation flagged, she fell to her work as furiously as if a husband and half a dozen sons were waiting for its completion. David often wondered in his secret soul what Josephine did with all the interminable gray socks she knitted. Sometimes he concluded that she put them in the home missionary barrels, again that she sold them to her hired man. At any rate, they were very warm and comfortable-looking, and David sighed as he thought of the deplorable state his own socks were generally in. When David sighed, Josephine took alarm. She was afraid David was going to have one of his attacks of foolishness. She must head him off some way, so she rolled up the gray sock, stabbed the big pudgy ball with her needles, and said she guessed she'd get the tea. David got up. "Now, you're not going before tea," said Josephine hospitably. "I'll have it all ready in no time." "I ought to go home, I suppose," said David, with the air and tone of a man dallying with a great temptation. "Zillah'll be waiting tea for me, and there's the stock to tend to." "I guess Zillah won't wait long," said Josephine. She did not intend it at all, but there was a certain scornful ring in her voice. "You must stay. I've a fancy for company to tea." David sat down again. He looked so pleased that Josephine went down on her knees behind the stove, ostensibly to get a stick of firewood, but really to hide her smile. "I suppose he's tickled to death to think of getting a good square meal, after the starvation rations Zillah puts him on," she thought. But Josephine misjudged David just as much as he misjudged her. She had really asked him to stay to tea out of pity, but David thought it was because she was lonesome, and he hailed that as an encouraging sign. And he was not thinking about getting a good meal either, although his dinner had been such a one as only Zillah Hartley could get up. As he leaned back in his cushioned chair and watched Josephine bustling about the kitchen, he was glorying in the fact that he could spend another hour with her, and sit opposite to her at the table while she poured his tea for him and passed him the biscuits, just as if. Here Josephine looked straight at him with such intent and stern brown eyes that David felt she must have read his thoughts, and he colored guiltily. But Josephine did not even notice that he was blushing. She had only paused to wonder whether she would bring out cherry or strawberry preserve, and, having decided on the cherry, took her piercing gaze from David without having seen him at all. But he allowed his thoughts no more vagaries. Josephine set the table with her mother's wedding china. She used it because it was the anniversary of her mother's wedding day, but David thought it was out of compliment to him. And as he knew quite well that Josephine prized that china beyond all her other earthly possessions, he stroked his smooth-shaven, dimpled chin with the air of a man to whom is offered a very subtly sweet homage. Josephine whisked in and out of the pantry and up and down cellar, and with every whisk a new dainty was added to the table. Josephine, as everybody in Meadowby admitted, was past mistress in the noble art of cookery. Once upon a time, rash matrons and ambitious young wives had aspired to rival her, but they had long ago realized the vanity of such efforts and dropped comfortably back to second place. Josephine felt an artist's pride in her table when she set the teapot on its stand and invited David to sit in. There were pink slices of cold tongue and crisp green pickles and spiced gooseberry, the recipe for which Josephine had invented herself, and which had taken first prize at the provincial exhibition for 6 successive years. There was a lemon pie, which was a symphony in gold and silver, biscuits as light and as white as snow, and moist plummy cubes of fruitcake. There was the ruby-tinted cherry preserve, a mound of amber jelly, and, to crown all, steaming cups of tea in flavor and fragrance unequaled. And Josephine, too, sitting at the head of the table, with her smooth, glossy crimps of black hair and cheeks as rosy clear as they had been 20 years ago, when she had been a slender slip of girlhood and bashful young David Hartley had looked at her over his hymn book in prayer meeting and tramped all the way home a few feet behind her, because he was too shy to go boldly up and ask if he might see her home. All taken together, what wonder if David lost his head over that tea-table, and determined to ask Josephine the same old question once more? It was 18 years since he had asked it for the first time, and 2 years since the last. He would try his luck again. Josephine was certainly more gracious than he remembered her to ever have been before. When the meal was over, Josephine cleared the table and washed the dishes. When she had taken a dry towel and sat down by the window to polish her china, David understood that his opportunity had come. He moved over and sat down beside her on the sofa by the window. Outside, the sun was setting in a magnificent arch of light and color over the snow-clad hills and deep blue St. Lawrence Gulf. David grasped at the sunset as an introductory factor. "Isn't it fine, Josephine?" he said admiringly. "It makes me think of that piece of poetry that used to be in the old fifth reader when we went to school. Do you mind how the teacher used to drill us up in it on Friday afternoons? It begun, 'Slow sinks more lovely ere his race is run, along Moria's hills the setting sun.' Then David declaimed the whole passage in a sing-song tone, accompanied by a few crude gestures recalled from long-ago schoolboy elocution. Josephine knew what was coming. Every time David proposed to her, he had begun by reciting poetry. She twirled her towel around the last plate resignedly. If it had to come, the sooner it was over, the better. Josephine knew by experience that there was no heading David off, despite his shyness, when he had once got along as far as the poetry. "But it's going to be for the last time," she said determinedly. "I am going to settle this question so decidedly tonight that there'll never be a repetition." When David had finished his quotation, he laid his hand on Josephine's plump arm. "Josephine," he said huskily, "I suppose you couldn't, could you now, make up your mind to have me? I wish you would, Josephine, I wish you would. Don't you think you could, Josephine?" Josephine folded up her towel, crossed her hands on it, and looked her wooer squarely in the eyes. "David Hartley," she said deliberately, "what makes you go on asking me to marry you every once in a while when I've told you times out of mind that I can't and won't?" "Because I can't help hoping that you'll change your mind through time," David replied meekly. "Will you just listen to me? I will not marry you. That is in the first place. And in the second, this is to be final. It has to be. You are never to ask me this again under any circumstances. If you do, I will not answer you. I will not let on I hear you at all. But," and Josephine spoke very slowly and impressively, "I will never speak to you again. Never. We are good friends now, and I like you real well, and like to have you drop in for a neighborly chat as often as you wish to. But there'll be an end, short and sudden, to that, if you don't mind what I say." "Oh, Josephine, ain't that rather hard?" protested David feebly. It seemed terrible to be cut off from all hope with such finality as this. "I mean every word of it," returned Josephine calmly. "You'd better go home now, David. I always feel as if I'd like to be alone for a spell after a disagreeable experience." David obeyed sadly and put on his cap and overcoat. Josephine kindly warned him not to slip and break his legs on the porch, because the floor was as icy as anything, and she even lighted a candle and held it up at the kitchen door to guide him safely out. David, as he trudged sorrowfully homeward across the fields, carried with him the mental picture of a plump, sonsy woman in a trim dress of plum-colored homespun and ruffled blue check apron haloed by candlelight. It was not a very romantic vision, perhaps, but to David it was more beautiful than anything else in the world. When David was gone, Josephine shut the door with a little shiver. She blew out the candle, for it was not yet dark enough to justify artificial light to her thrifty mind. She thought the big, empty house in which she was the only living thing was very lonely. It was so still, except for the slow tick of the grandfather's clock and the soft purr and crackle of the wood in the stove. Josephine sat down by the window. "I wish some of the centeners would run down," she said aloud. "If David hadn't been so ridiculous, I'd have got him to stay the evening. He can be good company when he likes. He's real well-read and intelligent. And he must have dismal times at home there with nobody but Zilla." She looked across the yard to the little house at the other side of it, where her French-Canadian hired man lived, and watched the purple spiral of smoke from its chimney curling up against the crocus sky. Would she run over and see Mrs. Leon Poirier and her little black-eyed, brown-skinned baby? No, they never knew what to say to each other. "If 'twasn't so cold, I'd go up and see Ida," she said. "As it is, I guess I'd better fall back on my knitting. For I saw Jimmy Centner's toe sticking through his socks the other day. How set back poor David did look, to be sure. But I think I've settled that marrying notion of his once and for all, and I'm glad of it." She said the same thing next day to Mrs. Tom Centner, who had come down to help her pick her geese. They were at work in the kitchen with a big tub full of feathers between them, and on the table a row of dead birds, which Leon had killed and brought in. Josephine was enveloped in a shapeless print wrapper, and had an apron tied tightly around her head to keep the down out of her beautiful hair, of which she was rather proud. "What do you think, Ida?" she said, with a hearty laugh at the recollection. "David Hartley was here to tea last night and asked me to marry him again. There's a persistent man for you. I can't brag of ever having had many beaux, but I've certainly had my fair share of proposals." Mrs. Tom did not laugh. Her thin little face, with its faded prettiness, looked as if she never laughed. "Why won't you marry him?" she said fretfully. "Why should I?" retorted Josephine. "Tell me that, Ida Centner." "Because it is high time you were married," said Mrs. Tom decisively. "I don't believe in women living single, and I don't see what better you can do than take David Hartley." Josephine looked at her sister with the interested expression of a person who is trying to understand some mental attitude in another which is a standing puzzle to her. Ida's evident wish to see her married always amused Josephine. Ida had married very young, and for 15 years her life had been one of drudgery and ill health. Tom Centner was a lazy, shiftless fellow. He neglected his family and was drunk half his time. Bitterby people said that he beat his wife when on the spree, but Josephine did not believe that, because she did not think that Ida could keep from telling her if it were so. Ida Centner was not given to bearing her trials in silence. Had it not been for Josephine's assistance, Tom Centner's family would have stood an excellent chance of starvation. Josephine practically kept them, and her generosity never failed or stinted. She fed and clothed her nephews and nieces, and all the gray socks whose destination puzzled David so much went to the Centners. As for Josephine herself, she had a good farm, a comfortable house, a plump bank account, and was an independent, unworried woman. And yet, in the face of all this, Mrs. Tom Centner could bewail the fact that Josephine had no husband to look out for her. Josephine shrugged her shoulders and gave up the conundrum, merely saying ironically in reply to her sister's remark, "And go to live with Zilla Hartley? You know very well you wouldn't have to do that. Ever since John Hartley's wife at the creek died, he's been wanting Zilla to go and keep house for him. And if David got married, Zilla'd go quick. Catch her staying there if you were mistress. And David has such a beautiful house. It's 10 times finer than yours, though I don't deny yours is comfortable. And his farm is the best in Meadowby and joins yours. Think what a beautiful property they'd make together. You're all right now, Josephine, but what will you do when you get old and have nobody to take care of you? I declare the thought worries me at night till I can't sleep. I should have thought you had enough worries of your own to keep you awake at nights without taking over any of mine," said Josephine dryly. "As for old age, it's a good ways off for me yet. When your Jack gets old enough to have some sense, he can come here and live with me. But I'm not going to marry David Hartley. You can depend on that, Ida, my dear. I wish you could have heard him rhyming off that poetry last night. It doesn't seem to matter much what piece he recites. First thing that comes into his head, I reckon. I remember one time he went clean through that hymn, beginning, 'Hark from the tombs a doleful sound.' And 2 years ago it was, 'To marry in heaven, as lackadaisical as you please.' I never had such a time to keep from laughing, but I managed it, for I wouldn't hurt his feelings for the world. No, I haven't any intention of marrying anybody, but if I had, it wouldn't be dear old sentimental easygoing David. Mrs. Tom plucked a goose down on the bench with an expression which said that she, for one, wasn't going to waste any more words on an idiot. Easygoing, indeed. Did Josephine consider that a drawback? Mrs. Tom sighed. If Josephine, she thought, had put up with Tom Sentner's tempers for 15 years, she would know how to appreciate a good-natured man at his real value. The cold snap which had set in on the day of David's call lasted and deepened for a week. On Saturday evening, when Mrs. Tom came down for a jug of cream, the mercury of the little thermometer thumping against Josephine's porch was below zero. The gulf was no longer blue, but white with ice. Everything outdoors was crackling and snapping. Inside, Josephine had kept roaring fires all through the house, but the only place really warm was the kitchen. "Wrap your head up well, Ida," she said anxiously when Mrs. Tom rose to go. "You've got a bad cold." "There's a cold going," said Mrs. Tom. "Everyone has it. David Hartley was up at our place today barking terrible, a real churchyard cough, as I told him. He never takes any care of himself. He said Zillah had a bad cold, too. Won't she be cranky while it lasts?" Josephine sat up late that night to keep the fires on. She finally went to bed in the little room opposite the big hall stove, and she slept at once and dreamed that the thumps of the thermometer flapping in the wind against the wall outside grew louder and more insistent until they woke her up. Someone was pounding on the porch door. Josephine sprang out of bed and hurried on her wrapper and felt shoes. She had no doubt that some of the Sentners were sick. They had a habit of getting sick at about that time of night. She hurried out and opened the door, expecting to see hulking Tom Sentner, or perhaps Ida herself, big-eyed and hysterical. But David Hartley stood there, panting for breath. The clear moonlight showed that he had no overcoat on, and he was coughing hard. Josephine, before she spoke a word, clutched him by the arm and pulled him in out of the wind. "For pity's sake, David Hartley, what is the matter?" "Zillah's awful sick," he gasped. "I came here because 'twas nearest. Oh, won't you come over, Josephine? I've got to go for the doctor, and I can't leave her alone. She's suffering dreadful. I know you and her ain't on good terms, but you'll come, won't you?" "Of course I will," said Josephine sharply. "I'm not a barbarian, I hope, to refuse to go to the help of a sick person if 'twas my worst enemy. I'll go in and get ready, and you go straight to the hall stove and warm yourself. There's a good fire in it yet. What on earth do you mean, starting out on a bitter night like this without an overcoat or even mittens, and you with a cold like that?" "I never thought of them. I was so frightened," said David apologetically. "I just lit up a fire in the kitchen stove as quick as I could and run. It rattled me to hear Zillah moaning so's you could hear her all over the house." "You need someone to look after you as bad as Zillah does," said Josephine severely. In a very few minutes she was ready, with a basket packed full of homely remedies. "For like as not, there'll be no putting one's hand on anything there," she muttered. She insisted on wrapping her big plaid shawl around David's head and neck, and made him put on a pair of mittens she had knitted for Jack Sentner. Then she locked the door, and they started across the gleaming crusted field. It was so slippery that Josephine had to cling to David's arm to keep her feet. In the rapture of supporting her, David almost forgot everything else. In a few minutes they had passed under the bare, glistening boughs of the poplars on David's lawn, and for the first time Josephine crossed the threshold of David Hartley's house. Years ago, in her girlhood, when the Hartleys lived in the old house and there were half a dozen girls at home, Josephine had frequently visited there. All the Hartley girls liked her except Zillah. She and Zillah never got on together. When the other girls had married and gone, Josephine gave up visiting there. She had never been inside the new house, and she and Zillah had not spoken to each other for years. Zillah was a sick woman, too sick to be anything but civil to Josephine. David started at once for the doctor at the creek, and Josephine saw that he was well wrapped up before she let him go. Then she mixed up a mustard plaster for Zillah and sat down by the bedside to wait. When Mrs. Tom Sentner came down the next day, she found Josephine busy making flaxseed poultices, with her lips set in a line that betokened she had made up her mind to some disagreeable course of duty. "Zillah has got pneumonia bad," she said in reply to Mrs. Tom's inquiries. "The doctor is here and Mary Bell from the creek. She'll wait on Zillah, but there'll have to be another woman here to see to the work. I reckon I'll stay. I suppose it's my duty, and I don't see who else could be got. You can send Mamie and Jack down to stay at my house until I can go back. I'll run over every day and keep an eye on things." At the end of a week, Zillah was out of danger. Saturday afternoon, Josephine went over home to see how Mamie and Jack were getting on. She found Mrs. Tom there, and the latter promptly dispatched Jack and Mamie to the post office that she might have an opportunity to hear Josephine's news. "I've had an awful week of it, Ida," said Josephine solemnly, as she sat down by the stove and put her feet up on the glowing hearth. "I suppose Zillah is pretty cranky to wait on," said Mrs. Tom sympathetically. "Oh, it isn't Zillah. Mary Bell looks after her." "No, it's the house. I've never lived in such a place of dust and disorder in my born days. I'm sorrier for David Hartley than I ever was for anyone before." "I suppose he's used to it," said Mrs. Tom with a shrug. "I don't see how anyone could ever get used to it," groaned Josephine. "And David used to be so particular when he was a boy. The minute I went there the other night, I took in that kitchen with a look. I don't believe the paint has even been washed since the house was built. I honestly don't. And I wouldn't like to be called upon to swear when the floor was scrubbed, either. The corners were just full of rolls of dust. You could have shoveled it out. I swept it out the next day, and I thought I'd be choked. As for the pantry, well, the less said about that, the better. And it's the same all through the house. You could write your name on everything. I couldn't so much as clean up. Zillah was so sick there couldn't be a bit of noise made. I did manage to sweep and dust, and I cleaned out the pantry. And, of course, I saw that the meals were nice and well cooked. You should have seen David's face. He looked as if he couldn't get used to having things clean and tasty. I darned his socks. He hadn't a whole pair to his name. And I've done everything I could to give him a little comfort. Not that I could do much. If Zillah heard me moving round, she'd send Mary Bell out to ask what the matter was. When I wanted to go upstairs, I'd have to take off my shoes and tiptoe up on my stocking feet, so she wouldn't know it. And I'll have to stay there another fortnight yet. Zillah won't be able to sit up till then. I don't really know if I can stand it without falling to and scrubbing the house from garret to cellar in spite of her. Mrs. Tom Sentner did not say much to Josephine. To herself, she said complacently, "She's sorry for David. Well, I've always heard that pity was akin to love. We'll see what comes of this." Josephine did manage to live through that fortnight. One morning she remarked to David at the breakfast table, "Well, I think that Mary Bell will be able to attend to the work after today, David. I guess I'll go home tonight." David's face clouded over. "Well, I suppose we oughtn't keep you any longer, Josephine. I'm sure it's been awful good of you to stay this long. I don't know what we'd have done without you." "You're welcome," said Josephine shortly. "Don't go for to walk home," said David. "The snow is too deep. I'll drive you over when you want to go." "I'll not go before the evening," said Josephine slowly. David went out to his work gloomily. For 3 weeks he had been living in comfort. His wants were carefully attended to, his meals were well cooked and served, and everything was bright and clean. And more than all, Josephine had been there, with her cheerful smile and companionable ways. Well, it was all ended now. Josephine sat at the breakfast table long after David had gone out. She scowled at the sugar bowl and shook her head savagely at the teapot. "I'll have to do it," she said at last. "I'm so sorry for him that I can't do anything else." She got up and went to the window, looking across the snowy field to her own home, nestled between the grove of firs and the orchard. "It's awful snug and comfortable," she said regretfully, "and I've always felt set on being free and independent, but it's no use. I'd never have a minute's peace of mind again, thinking of David living here in dirt and disorder, and him being so particular and tidy by nature. No, it's my duty, plain and clear, to come here and make things pleasant for him. The pointing of Providence, as you might say. The worst of it is, I'll have to tell him so myself. He'll never dare to mention the subject again after what I said to him that night he proposed last. I wish I hadn't been so dreadful emphatic. Now I've got to say it myself, if it is ever said. But I'll not begin by quoting poetry, that's one thing sure." Josephine threw back her head, crowned with its shining braids of jet-black hair, and laughed heartily. She bustled back to the stove and poked up the fire. "I'll have a bit of corned beef and cabbage for dinner," she said, "and I'll make David that pudding he's so fond of. After all, it's kind of nice to have someone to plan and think for. It always did seem like a waste of energy to fuss over cooking things when there was nobody but myself to eat them." Josephine sang over her work all day, and David went about his with the face of a man who is going to the gallows without benefit of clergy. When he came in to supper at sunset, his expression was so woebegone that Josephine had to dodge into the pantry to keep from laughing outright. She relieved her feelings by pounding the dresser with the potato masher, and then went primly out and took her place at the table. The meal was not a success from a social point of view. Josephine was nervous, and David was glum. Mary Bell gobbled down her food with her usual haste, and then went away to carry Zilla hers. Then David said reluctantly, "If you want to go home now, Josephine, I'll hitch up Red Rob and drive you over." Josephine began to plait the tablecloth. She wished again that she had not been so emphatic on the occasion of his last proposal. Without replying to David's suggestion, she said crossly. Josephine always spoke crossly when she was especially in earnest. "I want to tell you what I think about Zilla. She's getting better, but she's had a terrible shaking up, and it's my opinion that she won't be good for much all winter. She won't be able to do any hard work, that's certain. If you want my advice, I tell you fair and square that I think she'd better go off for a visit as soon as she's fit. She thinks so herself. Clementine wants her to go and stay a spell with her in town. 'Twould be just the thing for her." "She can go if she wants to, of course," said David dully. "I can get along by myself for a spell." "There's no need of you getting along by yourself," said Josephine more crossly than ever. I'll come here and keep house for you if you like." David looked at her uncomprehendingly. "Wouldn't people kind of gossip?" he asked hesitatingly. "Not but what—" "I don't see what they'd have to gossip about," broke in Josephine, "if we were married." David sprang to his feet with such haste that he almost upset the table. "Josephine, do you mean that?" he exclaimed. "Of course I mean it," she said in a perfectly savage tone. "Now, for pity's sake, don't say another word about it just now. I can't discuss it for a spell. Go out to your work. I want to be alone for a while." For the first and last time, David disobeyed her. Instead of going out, he strode around the table, caught Josephine masterfully in his arms, and kissed her. And Josephine, after a second's hesitation, kissed him in return. End of Akin to Love by Lucy Maud Montgomery.
The Friendship of Amos and Emile, translated by William Morris. The Friendship of Amos and Emile, translated by William Morris. In the time of Pepin, King of France, was a child born in the castle of Barricane, of a noble father of Allemagne, who was of great holiness. The father and the mother promised to God and St. Peter and St. Paul, whereas they had none other child, that if God gave it life, they would bear it to Rome to baptism. At the same time came a vision to a Count of Auvergne, whose wife was big with child, whereby it seemed that the Apostle of Rome was baptizing many children in his palace, and confirming them with chrism. So when the Count was awakened, he sought of many wise folk what might signify that which he had seen in his dream. And when his vision was uncovered, a wise man and ancient bespake him by the counsel of God, "Make great joy, Count, for there shall be born to thee a son full of great prowess and of great holiness, and him thou shalt let bear to Rome, and let baptize him by the apostle." Thereof great joy made the Count, and he and his folk praised the counsel of the elder. The child was born and dearly fostered, and when he had 2 years, and the father after his purpose was bearing him to Rome, he came to the city of Lucca, and therein he found a nobleman of Allemagne, who was wending Romeward and bearing his son to baptism. They greeted one the other, and each asked other who he was and what he sought, and when they found themselves to be of one purpose, they joined company in all friendliness and entered Rome together. And the two children fell to loving one another so sorely that one would not eat without the other. They lived of one victual, and lay in one bed. In this wise the fathers brought them before the apostle at Rome, and spake to him, "Holy Father, whom we know and believe to be in the place of St. Peter the apostle, the Count of Auvergne, and a noble knight of Barricane the castle, beseech your holiness that ye would deign to baptize their sons, which they have brought from far away, and that ye would take their little offering from their hands." And the apostle answered them, "I hold your gifts for right acceptable, but they are not to me of much necessity. Give them to the poor, who have need thereof. The infants will I baptize with a good will, that the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost may embrace them in the love of the Holy Trinity." Forthwith then the apostle baptized them in the church of the Holy Saviour, and laid for name on the son of the count, Amiel, and on the son of the knight, Amis. And many a knight of Rome held them at the font with mickle joy, and raised them aloft even as God would. And the office of baptism done, the apostle bade bring two hanabs of tree, dight with gold and precious stones, side and wide, alike, and of like fashion, and gave them to the barons, and said, Take these gifts in token that I have baptized you in the church of the Holy Saviour. Which gifts they took joyfully, and thanked him much, and betook them thence home in all joyance. To the child of Barachane did God give so great wisdom, that one might trow that he were another Solomon. And when he was of the age of 30 years, a fever took his father, and he fell to admonishing his son in such like words, Fair son, well beloved, it behooveth me presently to die, and thou shalt abide and be thine own master. Now firstly, fair son, keep thou the commandments of God. The chivalry of Jesus Christ do thou. Keep thou faith to thy lords, and give aid to thy fellows and friends. Defend the widows and orphans, uphold the poor and needy, and in all days hold thy last day in memory. Forget not the fellowship and friendship of the son of the Count of Alverne, whereas the apostle of Rome on one day baptized you both, and with one gift honored you. Ye be alike of beauty, of fashion and stature, and whoso should see you would deem you to be brethren. So having finished these words, and received his Saviour, he departed in our Lord, and his son did do bury him, and did do render him his service, even as one should do for the dead. After the death of his father, evil folk bore envy against him, and did him many a scathe, and grieved him sorely, but he loved them all, and suffered whatsoever they did to him. What more may I tell you, save that they cast him and his folk out of the heritage of his fathers, and chased him forth out of his castle? So when he bethought him of the commandment of his father, he said to them who went in his company, The wicked have wrongfully cast me forth out of mine heritage. Yet have I good hope in our Lord that he will help me. Go we now to the court of the Count Amiel, who was my friend and my fellow. Mayhappen he will make us rich with his goods and his havings. But if it be not so, then shall we go to Hildegard, the queen, wife of King Charles of France, who is wont to comfort the disinherited. And they answered that they were ready to follow him and do his bidding. Therewith they went their ways to the court of the count, and found him not there, because he was gone to Barachane to visit Amis, his fellow, and comfort him of the death of his father. And when he found him not, he departed sore troubled, and said to himself that he would not betake him to his own land, till he had found Amis, his fellow. And he sought him in France and Allemagne, wheresoever he heard tell that his kindred were, and could find no certainty of him. Therewithal Amis, together with his folk, ceased not to seek his fellow Amiel, until they came to the house of a nobleman where they were guested. Thereat they told by order all their adventure, and the nobleman said to them, Abide with me, sir knights, and I will give my daughter to your lord, because of the wisdom that I have heard of him, and I will make you all rich of gold and silver, and of havings. That word pleased them, and they held the bridal with mickle joy. But when they had abided there for a year and a half, then said Amis to his 10 fellows, We have done amiss in that we have left seeking of Amiel. And he left there 2 of his sergeants and his hanap, and went his ways toward Paris. Now by this time had Amiel been a-seeking for Amis 2 years past, without ceasing. And when as Amiel drew nigh to Paris, he found a pilgrim, and asked if he had seen Amis whom men had chased out of his land. And that one said, Nay, he had not. But Amiel did off his coat, and gave it to the pilgrim, and said, Pray thou to our Lord in his hallows, that they give me to find Amis my fellow. Then he departed from the pilgrim, and went his ways to Paris, and found no whither Amis his fellow. But the pilgrim went his ways forthwith, and about vespers happened on Amis, and they greeted each the other. And Amis said to the pilgrim, Had he seen or heard tidings in any land of Amiel, son of the Count of Alverne. And the pilgrim answered him, all marveling, Who art thou, knight, who thus mockest a pilgrim? Thou seemest to me that Emile, who this day asked of me if I had seen Amos his fellow. I wot not for why thou hast changed thy garments, thy folk, thine horses, and thine arms. Thou askest me now what thou didst ask me to-day about Terse, and thou gavest me this coat. Trouble not thine heart, said Amos. I am not he who thou deemest, but I am Amos who seekest Emile. And he gave him of his silver, and bade him pray our Lord to give him to find Emile. And the pilgrim said, Go thy ways forthright to Paris, and I trow that thou shalt find whom thou seekest, so sore longing. And therewith Amos went his ways full eagerly. Now on the morrow Emile was already departed from Paris, and was sitting at meat with his knights hard by the water of Seine, in a flowery meadow. And when they saw Amos coming with his fellows all armed, they rose up and armed them, and so went forth before them. And Amos said to his fellows, I see French knights who come against us in arms. Now fight heartily and defend your lives. If we may escape this peril, then shall we go with great joy to Paris, and there too shall we be received with high favor at the court of the king. Then were the reins let loose, and the spear shaken aloft, and the swords drawn on either side, in such wise that no semblance was there that any should escape alive. But God the Almighty, who seeth all, and who setteth an end to the toil of the righteous, did to hold aback them of one part, and of the other, when they were now hard on each other. For then said Amos, Who are ye, knights, who have willed to slay Amos the exile and his fellows? At that voice Emile knew Amos his fellow, and said, O thou Amos, most well-beloved, rest from my travail. I am Emile, son of the Count of Alverne, who have not ceased to seek thee for 2 whole years. And therewith they alighted down from their horses, and embraced and kissed each other, and gave thanks to God of that they were found. And they swore fealty and friendship and fellowship perpetual, the one to the other, on the sword of Emile, wherein were relics. Thence went they all together to the court of Charles, King of France. There might men behold them young, well-attempered, wise, fair, and of like fashion and visage, loved of all and honored. And the king received them much joyously, and made of Amos his treasurer, and of Emile his server. And when they had abided thus 3 years, Amos said unto Emile, Fair sweet fellow, I desire sore to see my wife whom I have left behind, and I will return the soonest that I may, and do thou abide at the court. But keep thee well from touching the daughter of the king, and above all things beware of Arderhai the felon. Emile answered him, I will take heed of thy commandment, but betake thee back hither so soon as thou mayest. Thuswise departed Amos, but Emile cast his eyes upon the king's daughter, and knew her so soon as he might, and right soon forgat he the commandment and the teaching of Amos his fellow. Yet is not this adventure strange, whereas he was no holier than David, nor wiser than Solomon. Amidst these things Arderhai the traitor, who bore him envy, came to him and said, Thou wottest not, fellow, thou wottest not, how Amos hath robbed the treasure of the king, and therefore is fled away. Wherefore I require of thee thou swear me fealty and friendship and fellowship, and I will swear the same to thee on the holy gospel. And so when that was done, Emile doubted not to lay bare his secret to Arderhai. But when as Emile was a-giving water to the king to wash his hands withal, the false Arderhai said to the king, Take thou no water from this evil man, sir king, for he is more worthy of death than of life, whereas he hath taken from the queen's daughter the flower of her virginity. But when Emile heard this, he fell down all astonied, and might say never a word, but the benign king lifted him up again, and said to him, Rise up, Emile, and have no fear, and defend thee of this blame. So he lifted himself up, and said, Have no will to trow, sire, in the lies of Arderhai the traitor, for I wot that thou art a right wise judge, and that thou turnest not from the right way, neither for love nor for hatred. Wherefore I pray thee that thou givest me frist of counsel, and that I may purge me of this guilt before thee, and do the battle against Ardiri the traitor, make him convict of his lies before all the court. So the king gave to one and the other frist of counsel till after nones, and that then they should come before him for to do their devoir. And they came before the king at the term which he had given them. Ardiri brought with him the Count Herbert for his part, but Emile found none who would be for him saving Hildegard, the queen, who took up the cause for him, and gat frist of counsel for Emile, on such covenant that if Emile come not back by the term established, she should be lacking all days of the bed of the king. But when Emile went to seek counsel, he happened on Amos, his fellow, who was betaking him to the king's court, and Emile lighted down from his horse, and cast himself at the feet of his fellow, and said, O thou, the only hope of my salvation, evilly have I kept thy commandment, for I have run into wight of the king's daughter, and I have taken up battle against the false Ardiri. Then said Amos, sighing, Leave we here our folk, and enter into this wood to lay bare our secret. And Amos fell to blaming Emile, and said, Change we our garments and our horses, and get thee to my house, and I will do the battle for thee against the traitor. And Emile answered, How may I go into thine house, who have no knowledge of thy wife and thy folk, and have never seen them face to face? But Amos said to him, Go in all safety, and seek wisely to know them, but take good heed that thou touch not my wife. And thuswise they departed each from his fellow weeping, and Amos went his ways to the court of the king, in the semblance of Emile, and Emile to the house of his fellow, in the semblance of Amos. But the wife of Amos, when she saw him betake him thither, ran to embrace him, whom she deemed was her husband, and would have kissed him. But he said, Flee thou from before me, for I have greater need to lament than to play, whereas since I departed from thee, I have suffered adversity full sore, and yet have to suffer. And at night time, when as they lay in one bed, then Emile laid his sword betwixt the two of them, and said to the woman, Take heed that thou touch me in no manner wise, else diest thou straightway by this sword. And in likewise did he the other knights, until Amos betook him in disguise to his house, to wot if Emile kept faith with him of his wife. Now was the term of the battle come, and the queen abode Emile all full of fear, for the traitor Ardiri said all openly that the queen should never more draw nigh the bed at the king, whereas she had suffered and consented hereto, that Emile should shame her daughter. Amidst these words, Amos entered into the court of the king, clad in the raiment of his fellow Emile, at the hour of midday, and said to the king, Right debonair and loyal judge, here am I apparelled to do battle against the false Ardiri, in defence of me, the queen, and her daughter of the white, which they lay upon us. And the king answered benignly, and said, Be thou not troubled, count, for if thou vanquishest the battle, I will give thee to wife Bilisant, my daughter. On the morrow's morn, Ardiri and Amos entered armed into the field in the presence of the king and his folk, and the queen, with much company of virgins, and widows, and wedded wives, went from church to church, making prayers for the champion of her daughter, and they gave gifts, oblations, and candles. And Amos fell to pondering in his heart that if he should slay Ardiri, he would be guilty of his death before God, and if he were vanquished, it should be for a reproach to him all his days. Wherefore he spake thus why to Ardiri, O thou count, foul reed thou hast, and that thou desirest my death so sorely, and hast foolishly cast thy life into peril of death, if thou wouldest but take back the wight which thou layest on me, and leave this mortal battle, thou mayest have my friendship and my service. But Ardiri, as one out of his wit, answered him, I will not of thy friendship nor thy service, but I shall swear the sooth as it verily is, and I shall smite the head from off thee. So Ardiri swore that he had shamed the king's daughter, and Amos swore that he lied, and straightway they dealt together in strokes, and fought together from the hour of Terse right on till Nones, and Ardiri was vanquished, and Amys mowed off his head. The king was troubled that he had lost Ardiri, yet was he joyous that his daughter was purged of her guilt, and he gave to Amys his daughter, and a great sum of gold and silver, and a city hard by the sea wherein to dwell, and Amys received the same with great joy. Then he returned at his speediest to his hostel wherein he had left Emile his fellow, but when as Emile saw him coming with much company of horse, he deemed that Amys was vanquished, and fell to fleeing. But Amys bade him return in all safety, for that he had vanquished Ardiri, and thereby was wedded for him to the king's daughter. Thence then did Emile betake him, and abode in the aforesaid city with his wife. But Amys abode with his wife, and it became measle by the will of our Lord, in such wise that he might not move from his bed, for God chastiseth him that he loveth. And his wife, who had to name Obias, had him in sore hate, and many a time strove to strangle him. And when Amys found that, he called to him two of his sergeants, Azones and Horatus, by name, and said to them, Take me out of the hands of this evil woman, and take my handnap privily, and bear me to the castle of Barricane. So when they drew nigh to the castle, folk came to meet them, and asked of them who was the feeble sick man whom they bore. And they said it was Amys, the master of them, who was become measles, and prayed them that they would do him some mercy. But nevertheless they beat the sergeants of Amys, and cast him down from the cart whereupon they were bearing him, and said, Flee hence speedily, if ye would not lose your lives. Then Amys fell a-weeping, and said, O thou, God debonair and full of pity, give me death, or give me aid from mine infirmity. And therewith he said to his sergeants, Bring me to the church of the Father of Rome, whereas God may, peradventure of his great mercy, purvey for my poverty. When they came to Rome, Constantine the apostle, full of pity and of holiness, and many a knight of Rome of them who had held Amys at the font, came to meet him, and gave him sustenance enough for him and his sergeants. And in the space of 3 years thereafter was so great famine in the city, that the father had will to thrust the son away from his house. Then spake Azonus and Horatus.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.